Hi guys, in the previous session we started discussing about what are all the components we need to understand for the confidence interval. Whenever we go for confidence interval, when we do this plus or minus, that two extremes, if you look at the normal distribution, one is highest end, one is the lowest. We can't say negative or positive also. I mean, see, marks never we offer in the negative. When I keep evaluating 100 students mark or 1000 students mark, never I will be giving mark in negative. It is all of only positive. But when we do normal distribution, all the least value will go in the left tail. All the highest value will go in the right tail. That is the only combination. There is no other combination. So this is how we need to interpret. So this is lowest end to find the interval, minus we are using highest end to find it, we are using plus. So these are all the thing we have considered. What is the point you need to remember? Recap, I'm doing. Whenever you know population mean and variance, interval estimate of population, whenever you are doing mean and known variance, you need to use this. Whenever you are going, population variance is unknown. Remember, population variance is given sample population, both variance if you have, even then you need to go for z-score. Whenever population variance is not given, only the sample variance, read carefully, sample variance is given, we need to go for t-test. So remember this concept. The moment you come to know population variance, you need to use this formula. The moment you come to, you are not at all given population related information, then you need to go for this formula, sample variance. Look at, there is no peak changes. X bar, this is mean value, this is variance. This is sample variance, this is population variance. Whichever is given, use the formula, then corresponding T value, Z value only will vary. Then N, sample size. Whatever the size is given, we need to take the square root. Nothing more. It's very easiest. Formula is same. Whether you need to refer Z value or T value is the only difference. There is no other difference. Let us move on to the next. For your understanding, Z distribution always will take perfect normalization because it has larger sample. T distribution, n close to 30, n is smaller, then the deviation would become more. This is not at all normal distribution. This is more or less normal distribution, red one. Whenever n is more and more, that is what the central limit theorem says. Already we have discussed what is central limit theorem. Now we need to solve this problem. So what is the problem? Read it. Read once. What I also can do, I can read out loud, that louder, that's all. I'll give just 30 seconds. Just read the problem alone. What are all the parameter? It is been given here. First, understand this. Then finally, z-score, they had given 95% itself. So we need to refer to z-score. That part also nothing to worry. Just read the problem. Now give your answer. Which test I need to use for this problem, solving this problem? Interval estimation only we are doing. This is called, whenever we are going for confidence interval, it is called interval estimation. They themselves have given the confidence interval. We no need to worry. 95% it is given. That's what we discuss later. Now tell me. Now tell me. what is the test we need to use? Z test or T test? Come on, guys, tell me. More than 30 seconds over. Now, what is the test? Either you can use chat window or you can use already desktop. Somebody have given, I think, no more thinking. It is examination means you need to give. These all our childhood level of learning. No thinking and all. I said clearly. Yeah.
It is T-test, ma'am. We use T-test.
No. That is a wrong interpretation. That is a clue I have given. No T-test. Look at carefully. I have given lot of emphasis. Listen, you are not noticing. I had given very clearly. When the population mean is given, you need to use this. When the population mean, that is unknown variance. Population mean, known both population mean and variance. See. Population variance is unknown, you use t-test. I said, I asked you to read this carefully. Now let us look into this problem. Look at here. What they had given? Population standard deviation. The variation is standard deviation. Other word, these are all interquartile ranges. So population standard deviation is known as, nowhere sample standard deviation is given. Now watch this problem carefully. That's why I hided this portion. Look at now. I read again. You have sampled 40 units. So our size is both, whatever the formula we are using, look at size is same. So no need to worry. T value, Z value only we need to change. That is where the trick. Otherwise you will end up with wrong answer. So N is 40. Fantastic. Next, what is the other parameter we can take? Mean is given. Sample mean is given. What is your mean value? 10.40. So that this X bar for both of the formula, X bar only. So fine, fantastic. They had given calculate 95% confidence interval. So alpha equal to 0.5. Already I said confidence interval is related to alpha. I said then whenever we are going for confidence interval, it has to be divided by 2. That is the reason divided by 2. See, this is confidence interval. This avoid this red portion. All the gray portion is our confidence interval. But we want to find out this region. So that this region we are subtracting, this region we are doing addition. That is the reason it is called alpha divided by 2. Rejection region, alpha divided by 2. Because 2 end, 2 fold, it is a kind of map. It has 2 fold. So that we are dividing by 2. That is the indication here, divided by 2. That 2 tail. Whenever you are doing this divided by 2, it is termed as 2 tail test. If you are doing alpha, then it is 1 tail test. That all we will discuss little bit later. Don't get confused right now. It is early stage. Now look at carefully. Read the word population standard deviation. That is the reason. Already I said these are all important. These points. Somewhere I had given. 1 minute. I will show you. What this population standard deviation, population variance, sample, these symbols, these all, what is the symbol we need to understand? If we understand these all, easily we can interpret that symbol notation only. Again, formula, that symbol notation, interpretations are required. If you miss that interpretation, it will go wrong. That's all, nothing more. Simplest problem. That is the reason sigma, we are noting it down 0.6 LBS. Now population variance is known to us. So the moment the population variance is known to us, we need to choose this formula. Only the variation is this component, Z component. T component or Z component is the only variation. Now how I have got Z alpha divided by 2? How I got, see, look at rest all substitution. I have written down here X bar. What is X bar? 10.4. What is sigma? 0.6. What is N? 40, so square root of n. Rest all known parameter, here it is consolidated. What is the only point you don't know? Z value. Z value 1.96. How I got that Z value 1.96 is the question. See, look at, there is a Z table. If it is examination, you will be getting Z value, Z table, Z sheet. Look at, 95% confidence interval is given in the problem statement itself, 95%. So Z value is 1.96. I need to refer from this table. Hope so you can see the cursor where I am pointing. So 1.96, these are all the popular confidence intervals, 70, 75, 80, 85, 90, 92, 95, 96, 98, 99. So that popular confidence interval only I have listed out. If you really look at the complete Z table, it will be available for most of the values. You no need to worry about it. Normally in your exam also, they will give either 95, 90, 99, even nothing wrong in it. If you by God also, nothing wrong in it for the examination. If you buy, I don't know whether they supply Z value table, Z table or not. So that this is 1.6, this is 1.9, this is 2.5. Like this, if you remember, that is, it gradually will increase. Look at 1.6, 1.9, 2.5. That's it. So now let us go back here. So I'm substituting 1.96. That's all, nothing more. After that, LKG level calculation, 10.4 plus or minus 0.86. If you simplify this all, you will get the answers. That's all. Nothing more. If you divide and take square root, you will get perfectly, and multiplication, you will get perfectly this. Now, what is the confidence interval is 10.21, 10.59. So finally, what is the inference we can conclude is, lot of measure the weight of the production. The least production, lot to measure the weight of the product. So now, when we need to measure the weight of the product. So whenever 10 to 10.59, 10.21 to 10.59, this is the interval. We can measure the weight of the product. This is one of the sample. So whenever the lowest threshold, highest threshold we want to calculate, we need to go for this confidence interval. Now this is over. This is one problem we started with. Let us move to second problem. Credit card launch. I want to give a credit card to the people. Read this problem for 30 seconds. Then we will analyze and take it forward. This affinity card is favor card, some offer, special offer, discount, something, that's all. Some credit card, nothing to worry, that vocabulary and all. I have a lot of students, 10,000 alumni. I want to give them some credit card launch. To whom I can give? Simply we can't give to everyone, no, they won't pay back. Normally in the real life also, credit card is based on CIBIL score. It is based on the income band. Now which income band they need to fix? Then they need to rely on this kind of test. Otherwise it is not possible. Without this kind of test, they can't achieve something fruitfully. All the bankers will do like this. Now tell me, what is the test we need to use? Guys, could you hear me? My internet says poor internet quality. Could you able to hear me?
Yes, ma'am, you're audible.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah, yeah. Now tell me what test we need to use, Z test or T test? Come on, guys. Again. Complete silence. Z test. Why? Because Z test. Look at population standard deviation is given. Close your eyes and use Z test. Nothing more. That's all. Whenever you have population standard deviation value freeze, it is Z test. That's all. Then you need to harvest all the parameters. You need to understand what is the population size, what is the sample size, what is the mean value, sample standard deviation. See, look at it, careful. Both are given. Even then you need to use only Z test because I know population standard deviation. With respect to population standard deviation, it is different calculation. The perfection would become much more better. Now confidence interval 95%. There is no confidence interval given here. Now my choice. In this problem, no confidence interval. So always confidence interval is too large that will dilute. So that 95 or 90, that is more than enough confidence interval. Now, based on the sample mean, we should not take the decision because it has involved with the uncertainty. You may ask question, why we should not take sample mean? Always sample mean involved with uncertainty, or that is the reason we need to prefer this one. Population, we need to take decision based on population. Uncertainty is more with sample. Now this is the formula we are going to use. Again the same formula, nothing more. Substitute, x bar is what? Mean value is given, x bar. Next, z value is 1.96. Just now we have seen 95% confidence interval. The same I am retaining, so that 95% confidence interval, 1.96. So next, what is sigma? Sigma is known, population variance. So 2500 I know well. Square root, Excel I used and I computed. Square root, what is 140? What is this 140? Sample size. It is given the sample size. We are picking only this population standard deviation, nothing more. This one we are dropping. Although it is given in the problem statement, we need to drop it. Then 2.11, this portion will give you the value 2.11. This portion will give you the value 2.11. Then you are going for the interval with the addition. Here you are going for the interval with the subtraction. So you will be getting, this is the range. Now what is the interpretation now? The interpretation of this, I can launch a credit card, affinity card or whatever. Those who have the balance or average income, $1,500 between this range, approximately. I can go lesser also, bit lesser. If you argue with me, 2,500, should I not go? Yes, you can go. Little bit you can extend. This is valid answer, or concretely it fixes and gives the interval to whom I can go for launching the credit card. This is finally the dollar representation, 1,575. to 2,404. You can little bit reduce also. For example, you can come here 1,500. Here you can go up to 2,450. See, normally 50 rupee, dollar 50, dollar 100 is also what? Like Indian currency, 50 rupees, 100 rupees. You and me, never we will think of each other giving 50 rupees, 100 rupees each other. So that is the way you need to interpret. You can go up to $3,000 also. Here $1,000 also you can think of. But this is precisely statistical evidence. It is created that for this interval or within this band of income, we can issue the credit card. That's all. So whomever maintains the average balance in their account, you can offer. So these are all the balance we are considering. Balance sheet, we need to average balance of that holder, account holder. To them, you can issue a credit card. You will not end up with lot of loss, maybe minimal loss. One or two cheating cases or one or two inability to pay back may happen, but not all. This is a safe zone. This determines the safe zone. That's all. Hope so you would be understanding with the two problems, Z test we have solved two problem. Here look at, here no confusion at all should come to you guys, because there is no sample standard deviation is given at all. Or straightly the word given is population standard deviation, straight to the point. The moment you use population, immediately you need to go for Z test. I'm recapping. Look at here. You at least I can say you may face difficulty because population standard deviation is also given. Look at here. Average balance maintained by this and standard deviation is this. Sample standard deviation is also given. Now you have a trick. If you substitute this, you will end up with a different answer. You will not end up with answer of mine. You need to substitute this. Since it is given, I should prefer population standard deviation, because standard deviation itself involves with what? Mean. So what is the reason for that? Why I'm using? We should not take decision because it has involved with uncertainty. Sample, always sample has uncertainty. In order to avoid this uncertainty situation, always whenever a chance is given in the problem to know about population standard deviation, you need to go for Z test. The entire formula is same. Look at that previous slide. Only the change is your question whether to use Z test or T test is the only change. That's all. Hope so you would be clear right now. So this is what you can use confidence interval, search for the command. You do command for confidence interval computation in R and Excel. The same what you did manually, instead you need to do it for through commands, either be it R or Excel. So whichever you feel comfortable, you can use this. Now coming to the next important topic, hypothesis test. After hypothesis test introduction, I will go to t-test, because immediately if I start t-test, you may get a little bit puzzled. So let it be. Right now, this is sufficient. We go for hypothesis test. Be it research problem or be it your survey or even industrial real-time problem, you need to formulate a hypothesis. Otherwise, you will end up or mess up with a lot of confusions. So hypothesis test plays a vital role in statistical as well as data science related field. So what we need to do? Just because of mean and standard deviation, we can't able to these are all helpful for overall understanding. We can't do any other conclusion. When we want to do conclusion, hypothesis test only will help you for taking conclusion. These all a kind of inferences. We need to find out descriptive statistics, then we need to go for hypothesis testing. What is hypothesis testing? Let us see. Already you will, by this time you will come to know. See, 80% of the year Melbourne receives finding out this value only. This Z test, Z test will be helpful. 440 mm to 800 mm. 80% of all years Melbourne receives this interval. Looking into the data, you can calculate mean and variance. After that, choose either one of the test. If you know population, you can go for population Z test. If you know only the sample variance, you can go for T test. That's all. The moment you come to this kind of calculation, it is termed as interval estimate. Most of the time, hypothesis is related to interval estimation. That is another inference. Now let us go for how mathematically people used to give the notation. Hypothesis test, you step into this concept, you will hear two terminologies. One is null hypothesis, another one is alternative hypothesis. So when you look at null hypothesis, mathematically people may use H0, H0, they used to call H0. Then suffix also they will represent. Alternate hypothesis, they used to represent HA or H suffix A. Whatever the notation you feel comfortable, you can do. What is the meaning is, when the mean of this and mean of this is no changes happening with the mean of both of the values. You have two comparative study, two process, two flight arrival time, two flight departure time, two different class mark score. It can be anything. I'm comparing one set of class to another set of class. I'm comparing income of male and income of female. I'm comparing IQ level of male group and IQ level of female group. Like that, two comparisons if you have. Whenever you go for, you have three sample tests. The moment three sample test, if I say, you need to go for ANOVA. These are all for two samples. So two samples, mean value, no change you need to climb. You need to climb, there is no change. Whenever you come to alternative hypothesis, not at all equal, there is a considerable change. That is a another interpretation. This is technical interpretation. Now I will come to the colloquial interpretation of null hypothesis and alternate hypothesis. What is H0 is, H0 will not encourage anything. See, for example, I want to find out section A, section B, who is doing well with respect to business analytics. I want to give them appreciation or a treat. When I want to give a treat to the best performing class, there are two sections I'm having. Section A, Section B. Both of the sections I am only handling. Finally, depending upon their academic performance, I wanted to give a treat or party. Then I want to find out which class is performing well. Merely based on mean and based on variance, it is little bit trick to find out the best performing class. So that we need to go for a little bit next level. That next level analysis only hypothesis testing. In the hypothesis testing, I want to consider which class I want to give a party. A section mark performance is available with me. B section mark performance is available with me. What that null hypothesis says is there is no big difference between those two class. Don't give party for both of the class. That is the meaning. It will discourage us. Null hypothesis will discourage us to take any action. Coming to the alternate hypothesis, what it says is, it encourages. Yes, there is a difference. A is performing well than B, or B is performing well than A. That inference it will give me. It will guide me for my thought process, for my hypothesis, or for my decision making. Finally, what is my decision? Which section I need to give a party based on their performance, academic performance, I want to give a party. So for that, null hypothesis always will discourage. Alternate hypothesis will encourage. That is the, if I say there is no difference, role number one, role number two, there is no difference at all. If I say, what is the meaning? I'm discouraging you. If I say they both are doing well, however, role number two is good in communication. Like that, if I do, I'm just trying to differentiate. So finally, alternate hypothesis will differentiate. Null hypothesis will not differentiate. This is the colloquial communication with one of the example I'm trying to tell. So no change it will tell. So this will tell considerable change. That's all. So with this word, you can able to understand what is the interpretation of each of the hypothesis, null hypothesis and alternate hypothesis. This will say no change. If it says no change, then what can I take a decision? It is very tough now for me to take decision. No change means, for example, I want to give you a loan for a set of people. I am dividing your section into two different half of section. First six members are in one category, another six members are in one category. So I want to take decision to whom I can give a loan, or I can you can borrow from me, to whom, how I can decide whether I need to give money to that people or not, based on will they pay interest or will they pay back perfectly. Whatever the lending I had given, they need to pay back. The borrower should pay back. So for that analysis, null hypothesis will tell there is no difference between this category, this category. Null, this alternate hypothesis will precisely guide me. Now, I can't say precisely also. Statistics, when it comes, bit relative only. Relatively will guide me. The first five, six students are reliable, or it will tell me second six students are reliable. You can lend money. that indication is given by hypothesis test by the alternate hypothesis. This one you need to strongly understand to proceed further. Let us go for compute the probability. P norm for Z test, PT for T test in R. So this is what zigzag it became. This is the answer for your question. If I would have given this question long back, I need to give you that clue. Let it be. Now, probability value, P value you need to fix. What is that P value? Yes, fix alpha value 0.5. When most of the hypothesis test, they used to fix 0.5. Just now we have seen it is a 95% confidence interval. Whenever you go for 95% confidence interval, you need to fix 0.5. Or else always alpha value, you need to find out P value. Next, you need to fix alpha value. These are all the two things you need to consider. Compare alpha with P value. You need to remember these two terminology when it comes to hypothesis. Value and P value. That's all. Nothing more you have. This confidence interval, you need to take advice from the expert if it becomes a real-time problem or business case study. For the academic problem, always you can fix 95%. Next, which hypothesis you need to accept first, which hypothesis you need to reject? That is your second question. If P value is less than alpha, reject H naught. That means you are accepting alternative hypothesis. This is the final claim you need to remember strongly in your brain. P value must be less than alpha. You are rejecting H naught. I have done a lot of this kind of analysis in my PhD, one of the chapter. I will show if time permits. I need to find out that notebook. I will show how I was doing this all for the chi-square value. I did chi-square computation. That is different phenomena altogether. That for the chi-square, the same method only I need to do. I need to formulate null hypothesis. I need to formulate alternative hypothesis. The mathematical portion only will vary. Chi-square I need to do. Every problem will vary. Finally, you need to find out or come out probability value. That is P value. Alpha value is related to confidence interval. That P value is less than alpha value, you need to reject H naught, or you can accept HA, whatever, vice versa. Fix one thing in your brain. Don't confuse with everything. This is the only one rule. If you remember all other thing, it can come well. P value must be less than alpha value in order to reject H naught. So this is the thumb rule you need to consider. Let us look into another one problem. We can compare before and after two process has been improved in yielding, bringing a change in an important factor X. Yield data are collected for old and new process. For example, yield agricultural crops or yield, you can consider anything. So I am doing some different treatment. This process A, process B, before and after. Some data we have got. We need finally comparing whether this group is better or this group is better. There is one more analogy also I can tell. For example, pharma A, pharma company. Another pharma company B. Both are coming out with COVID vaccination. How can I do? I need to compare whether this pharma company is doing best drug or this pharma company is doing best drug. So for that, I need to sample. This is pharma A. All the sample reading I need to collect. This is pharma B. All the sample reading of that pharma B drug I need to collect. I can observe the improvement or negative, anything I can observe. Progress in cure, recovery speed. I'm taking 100 patient. I'm giving drug A. The patient is cured within 3 days. I'm giving drug B, different patient. That particular patient cured within 4 days. Then pharma A. Again, I'm taking patient number 2, 4, because everybody's immunity recovery speed is different. Then 5. Like this, it will go. So two different pharma drug, how can I take decision which is doing better? I need to give approval. Maybe I am the government authority to approve for this pharma A medicine or pharma B medicine. Then I need to give the sample size. So this sample, maybe 100 people, they can verify. I can give the conditions or regulation. These, similarly, this drug company also can give 100 members. So they need to administer the drug for both of the company need to administer for 100 patients, different patient. That is fine, fantastic. So then larger the sample, better the evidence always. So even if they go for drug administration for minimum 250, that would be much more better. That is second phenomena, that is called central limit theorem. So let it be, whatever. So next, coming to, I need to recovery speed I am recording. For these 200 patients, I am the doctor. So here similarly, another doctor administering with pharma D medicine. So we need to collect all the recovery days, number of days for their recovery. Now, 200 human brain cannot take decision. If it is 2, what you will tell? Look at, this is always more, this is always more. Now, blindly, I can conclude for pharma A is the best medicine because it gives quick recovery. 3 days, 4 days it is giving. Whereas pharma B is taking. If it is 2 sample, you can take decision by your thought process itself. If it becomes 200 sample, you should not go for human judgment. It is a little bit tedious to take decision by the observation or looking at the data. By the time only, we are relying on this kind of statistical test or hypothesis test. So these are all the situations you need to go for hypothesis test. Similarly, this is another data. This is another data. Two different data I'm giving you for understanding. Is there a real difference between process A, process B? With this phenomena, if you understand, that's well and good. If not, try to interpret this. I need to take judgment whether product or drug A or drug B, which drug is good or which drug is better. Whether drug A or drug B. That's all. This is what hypothesis test helps us in taking decision. Come here. In a test procedure, to start with, hypothesis test is made. First, we need to write that hypothesis test. See, here I just introduced null hypothesis, alternate hypothesis. Here, how can I write for this particular pharma problem? HO. I need to write, there is no difference between drug A and drug B. This is a writing hypothesis is much more important, guys. Understand clearly. That is the reason I'm writing in front of you. HA, alternate hypothesis. There is a difference between these two drugs. Enough, because the above I have written clearly. Which two drugs? Drug A, drug B. You give name also. You may come out with some name for this. I don't have name. That's why I'm keeping drug A, drug B. It will have, if it becomes real-time example, you can compare metacin and anacin. Two different tablet you can compare. That is your choice. Now I don't have the tablet name, so that I am writing drug A and drug B. There is a difference between these two drugs. If you wish, you can write like this also. There is a difference between R, you can write like this, drug A and drug B. That's all. Now your p value and alpha value relativity, p value must be less than alpha value. Based on that, you can take decision whether there is a significant difference. You can write, there is no significant difference. This is another way to write, much more scientific way. There is a significant difference. You can write like this. First, you need to write down the hypothesis. First step, this is how you need to understand the problem. You need to formulate the hypothesis. Next step, the validity of the hypothesis you need to test. If the hypothesis found to be true, it is accepted. If it is found to be untrue, it is rejected. That's all. Null hypothesis denoted by H naught. Alternate hypothesis, which is accepted when null hypothesis is rejected, is called alternate hypothesis. Already I said this. Next, the alternate hypothesis often the interesting one, and often the one that someone sets out to prove. Look at here. I said na alternate only interesting, because alternate only says there is a difference between rule number one and rule number two. Null hypothesis discourages me. It says both guys are safe. Then what can I do? How can I take decision? Say I am the government authority. I need to approve either A or B, or I need to approve both. Statistically, I need to do evidence. After statistics, it says there is no difference. I can approve both of the drugs. After statistics only, I can take decision. Initially, it will discourage no significant difference. This one, it will tell that there is a significant difference. Look at here. Writing hypothesis. The drug works, it has a real effect. The drug doesn't work, any effect you saw was due to chance. You can write like this also. So it's all context dependent, problem dependent. But finally, you need to write null hypothesis with there is no difference. Alternate hypothesis, there is a significant difference. That's all. Now finally, let us go for sum up. You need to go for null hypothesis, alternate hypothesis, confidence interval. What is decision rule? P value is less than alpha value, like that. Then test statistic. Which statistic you are using? It may be t-test, z-test or ANOVA. Anything it could be. Chi-square test also. Depending upon your problem statement only, this test statistics will go. Finally, decision. You need to form the decision rule. You need to test for the statistics. Finally, you should take decision. These are all the major steps involved into hypothesis testing. Now we are going for t-test. Slowly we are coming. After this, we are stepping into t-test. Read this problem. With that, we will stop. A supermarket plans to launch a loyalty program. If it results, what is loyalty program? Some discount or special offer, anything. If it results in an average spending per shopper of more than $120 per week, they are fixing this rule. Those who are all purchasing, average spending per shopper per month or per week, anything I can take. They didn't specify the duration here. $120 anyone spends, I want to launch a some offer or some loyalty program. A random sample of 80 shoppers enrolled in this pilot program spent an average of more than, I'm telling no, so that they are coming out with $130. Average mean is given. 80 shoppers in a week. This is for week. Now we got to know the duration. With a standard deviation of $40. Should the loyalty program be launched or not is the question. For that, we need to work out. Look at carefully. No population. X bar is given 130. The mean. Spent on, this is my ceiling. I am fixing to whom I can give. That is the mean. Spending average mean. This is spent on average of 130. This is X bar. Sample yes only given. No, never the population is available here. Read the problem statement. So S is equal to 40. N is equal to 80. Number of sample I'm taking 80. Mu is equal to 120. What is the mu value? Average spending per shopper 120. After this, don't take any decision. You can take action. That what is the meaning here? You can give that special discount. What is this word given? Loyalty program. You can launch a loyalty program. You don't launch a loyalty program, it says. Launch a loyalty program, it says HA, H naught. Now mu is less than or equal to 20. Mu is greater than or equal to 20. Listen carefully. One more component I am bringing here now. Mu value, mu value. Alternate hypothesis is always encourages, so that what I need to write, mu value greater than 20 only I need to write. null hypothesis always discourages, so that what I need to write? Mu value less than or equal to 120. You can raise a question why I can't write interchangeably. You can't write. See, this program says what? I am a supermarket proprietor. To whom I can give? In my mind, I decided 120 per week, those who are all spending in my shop only, I want to give. Less than that, I don't want to give. So that I want to win the situation. I should not lose. So that less than 120 is discouraging option. So that I am putting that mu value into H naught. I am putting this mu value into HA. These are all the two new steps I'm including. Already I have written mu A is not equal to mu B and mu A is equal to mu B. Here mu A equal to mu B. Here that is one more hypothesis, that equality, this is greater than two different, two tail or single tail. I will write here when you can say two tail. Whenever greater than or less than combination comes, it is called two tail. You are comparing whether that end or this end. Okay, sorry, this is one tail. Either one end you are biased. You want either one end. Whenever you see equal to, not equal to, that is called two tail. You are considering both end. So that is a thumb rule you need to remember. Once again, I will recap when t-test comes in the next class. Look at here. You take the action if mu is greater than 120. Just to plug in t-test. Yeah, guys, discontinued due to internet issue. Okay, let us continue. So when you want to work with R, you can use the command PT. How to use this PT? Already I said with R, you can't decide with greater than. You can decide only with less than, so that you can do 1 minus. That's all. 1 minus PT of 2.2,79. This, what is this 2.2? What is this 79? This 79 is degrees of freedom. What is this 79 degrees of freedom? Look at here. Number of samples are 80. So that it is written 79 degrees of freedom. Rest all how you have calculated. 130 minus 120 divided by 40 divided by square root of 80. What is that 40? Look at variance. N is equal to 80. X bar, mu value. Whatever is available with us, that only substituted. You need to substitute to the command called PT with that computed value is 2.2. With that computed value, you need to supply number of degrees of freedom. Degrees of freedom is 79, n minus 1. See, t-test value, comma, degrees of freedom. You can find out a command for t-test calculation also. Then after that, with the command, whatever it gives, that value you can plug in here. Then degrees of freedom n minus 1. So with that, this is t-test value. Finally, t-test value of this problem is 2.2. You need to give degrees of freedom. That will find out the probability value. That probability you need to compare with, see, this is the obtained probability. 0.015 is the obtained probability. Alpha value 95% confidence interval. Now you can compare. If the p-value is less than the alpha value, null hypothesis is rejected, alternate hypothesis is accepted. Now it happens, see, p value is less than alpha, so we need to reject the null hypothesis. Hence final conclusion is we can launch the loyalty scheme to all the customers based on the alternate hypothesis. What my alternate hypothesis is saying, those who are all average expenditure spending with my shop greater than 120, yes, they are all worth to give a offer, so I can go with offer. That's all. Now compare both of them, decide. That's all. Now look at this, completely plugged in, all the relatives are there. Look at null hypothesis, the additional spending is less than or equal to $120. Writing the hypothesis, H naught is mu less than or equal to mu naught 120, less than mu is less than 120. What is your alternate hypothesis? Mu is greater than 120. Acceptance level of type 1 error is 0.05. Your confidence interval, you are fixing 0.05. Then how you are calculating the t-test? This is how you are plugging into the formula, you are calculating. Then you need to go for probability p-value computation. That p-value is 0.015 actually, but they neglected that 5. They have considered this in this approach. That's all. Now launch the loyalty card. So it gives a signal for us. You can launch the loyalty card. It is valid. Now with this one small matter, I will conclude. Variants of t-test, we are going to look into next class. One sample t-test. Look at only one sample, one particular class. Your section mark only. I want to take some decision. I need to work on only one class mark. So that it is called one sample. Then what is two sample? I want to compare class A mark with class B mark. We need to compare with, then here we need to compare with standard value, whereas here we need to compare two classes. Now look at what is one tail test. This is used to test either one side of the tail in the normal distribution. Whenever less than greater than relationship comes, underline this point. This kind of relationship is word greater than word or less than word. This kind of words are given in your problem statement. This kind of relationships are given in your problem statement. You need to go for one tail t-test. Next, come to here, this concept of one tail t-test. Next is two tail t-test. When you should use, this is what already I specified. Whenever in the problem statement, section A is equal to section B. Section A is not equal to section B. That kind of analysis, if I want to do, this kind of relationship, equal, not equal, like that word, if they are giving, then this is called two tail t-test. This is used to test on both sides of the tail in the normal distribution, in which here you will have only one p-value. In here you will have two p-value. This one, here you will have only one p-value. You will have one p-value. Here you will have, because it is on only one tail, one end. Here you will be doing on both end. So you will have two different p-value. Finally, you need to add it, combine it, and you need to proceed further. So this is how these are all the test works on. Combination, one sample t-test and one tail. You can go for one sample, two tail also. Two sample t-test, one tail. Two sample t-test, two tail. These are all the possible combinations. Whenever problems are given, we need to be careful which need to be chosen. That decision only very important. We need to discuss for further classes. What are all the way? Finally, look at one more chart. Develop null and alternate hypothesis. Select the test statistic. Determine the significant level of alpha value. Determine rejection criteria. Calculate test statistics. Finally, whether to accept the hypothesis based on the statistics or not. This is as a recap. Next class, we are going for this. Within that, look at less than or equal to relationship itself, you have two type, Z test and T test. Whenever you go for Z, you should know population variance or standard deviation. Whenever you need to go for T test, population is not given, only sample is given, you need to go for this. This all the time you need to remember. For this itself, you have two relationship, two tail, that one tail itself, greater than or less than, that one tail itself, you have two different tests, Z test and T test. Z test, whenever population variance is given, you need to prefer Z test. Whenever sample variance only given, then you need to go for T test. That's all. These are all the summarization. Next class, let us continue with few problem for this case. One sample, two sample, and one tail and two tail.